It's a real pleasure to be here tonight, and I want to thank you all for coming here tonight and for all your support to MSK through the years. So as Samantha said, until a few months ago, I was at the Dana-Farber Cancer Institute, a very nice cancer institute about 200 miles north of here. And as I was thinking about the reasons tonight of why I came down here, I just want to list a few of them to you. One is I grew up in New York. I grew up in Forest Hills. I did my part of my training in New York. So this is home to me. My children are all here, which is terrific. I have three children who are grown up. And I do want to point out that despite the fact that I lived in Boston for so many years, 28 years, I still rooted for New York teams, which got me into a lot of trouble. But one of the main reasons that I came here was I looked from a distance and saw that this was an incredibly exciting time at Memorial Sloan Kettering. It's a time of great change, change in leadership, change in vision, and it's become a epicenter for two areas in oncology, one being in precision medicine. What's being done in that area, which you may hear about a little bit tonight, is spectacular. Patients' tumors are being sequenced, and new opportunities for patients who would have otherwise have no opportunities are being provided for them. And the other area that's very exciting here is that this has become the epicenter for immuno-oncology, which you'll also hear about tonight, and I'll touch on a little bit as well. And the exciting thing about immuno-oncology is that we're not only seeing responses to therapy, but we're seeing a subset of patients with advanced cancers who look like they're being cured, who are long-term survivors. And this is really, I believe, the tip of the iceberg of what we'll see in the future in immuno-oncology, as well as in precision medicine. So I'm just gonna briefly cover a few topics tonight, including a couple areas of interest, and also feature a very important thing that I feel is very important, and that is feature the development of young investigators. And we're gonna hear from two outstanding young investigators tonight. This is the future. This is the next generation of people who will lead us through and find cures for this terrible disease. This is what I'm going to talk about very briefly today. I'm going to give a 30,000-foot overview of a few things. And the first topic is elephants and cancer. You're saying, "What? This guy must be crazy." But there is a connection there. The emergence of immunotherapy or immuno-oncology, and finally young investigators. I'm just gonna take about 10, 15 minutes of your time and then hand it over to our young stars here. So first of all, elephants and cancer. I was very intrigued by this paper that was published in the Journal of the American Medical Association a few months ago, and the title of it is Potential Mechanisms for Cancer Resistance in Elephants and Comparative Cellular Response to DNA Damage in Humans. So it turns out in this article, they point out something that I really never thought about before, but in mammals, we're mammals, elephants are mammals, it really does not matter how long a mammal lives or how big a mammal lives, that will, if a mammal is bigger or lives longer, that doesn't mean that they're more inclined to develop cancer. Curious when we think about aging and the number of cells that are susceptible to cancer. Now, elephants, despite their large size and their long life expectancy, have a relatively low incidence of cancer. So our lifetime risk of developing cancer, that is humans, not elephants, is 25%, where elephants are about 5%. And the observation that they made in this paper was that as opposed to humans, which have actually, I said one copy here, we have two copies of a gene called P53. Elephants have 20 copies of P53. So what is P53? It's a gene. P53 prevents cancer formation and assists in DNA repair. DNA, as you all know, is the genetic code. It's double-stranded. And it gives all the information in every cell to function, to develop into whatever type of cell it should develop into. P53 is also called the guardian of the genome because it has an essential role in DNA repair, which I'll talk about in a second. Every cell, as I said, has two copies in it. Some people, interestingly, are born with one copy of the gene. And actually, before that was recognized, there was a syndrome that was identified called the Lee-Fraumeni syndrome, which is characterized by the development of all sorts of different cancers. And then people studied families with Lee-Fraumeni, and it ultimately led to the discovery that these people lacked one copy of the P53 gene, making them more susceptible to cancer. And P53, as it turns out, is the most commonly mutated cancer, mutated gene in cancer. Over 50% of cancers have loss of P53, which is involved in DNA repair. So DNA integrity is very important to us. Every cell is constantly being exposed to environmental influences that cause damage in DNA, and the most common type of damage that occurs is single-strand. Remember, it's double-stranded. Single-strand breaks. And we have incredible sophisticated mechanisms to fix DNA DNA breakage. Single DNA, single-strand DNA breakage is fixed by certain types of mechanisms. And when they're fixed, the cell becomes normal again. Sometimes it's missed, and that leads to a mutation. And that mutation can have untoward side effects. Even worse are double-stranded breaks, where both strands of the DNA break. And there are different mechanisms involved in the repair of double-stranded breaks. But ultimately, double-stranded breaks, if they are not repaired, lead to cell death. Or they can lead to chaos in the cell and the formation of cancer, as can single-strand breaks. But ultimately, when double-strand breaks don't get repaired, the cell will die. So the importance of DNA integrity is so high that there are many proteins, genes involved in maintaining DNA integrity. And some of these genes you may recognize. Here, P53 is right in the heart of those genes. BRCA1, BRCA2, as you know, involved in breast cancer. The reason when people lose a copy of BRCA1 that they may develop breast cancer or ovarian cancer is because of the DNA repair problem. But these are many but not all of the different genes that are involved in DNA repair. Here's BRCA2, BRCA1, P53, ATM, and a whole bunch of other genes. These are critical genes to keep the integrity of DNA. Now, when these genes get mutated, then cancers can occur. So many of the DNA repair genes are mutated in cancer. P53, as I said before, mutated in about 50% of cancers. BRCA1 and BRCA2, inherited abnormalities in these genes can lead to ovarian cancer or to breast cancer. And other cancers as well, as I'll talk about. The Fanconi genes, which were listed in that complicated slide I showed before, mutations in these genes can lead to a variety of different cancers. And MSH2 is a gene that's involved in mismatch repair, and when it's mutated, usually in a hereditary fashion, it can lead to colon cancer. So these are very important genes in the development of cancer. I'm going to shift gears a little bit and talk about a project that I've been involved in, and actually Wassim has been involved in for the past few years. So several years ago, we asked the question, can we take a look at patients with advanced prostate cancer and look at the tumors themselves, the advanced tumors, and understand the mutational landscape of these tumors. Now, this slide is important because it shows how collaborative different institutions can be with each other. So here's me, probably, I don't know, 20 years ago. This is when I was still up in Boston, and I was involved in the formation of this very outstanding group of investigators, including investigators here, Charles Sawyers, Howard Scheer, Wassim, people from Great Britain, from the Royal Marsden, across the country. And we got together, we cooperated to do this very complicated project of biopsying patients with advanced prostate cancer and determining the mutational architecture of men with advanced prostate cancer. And I'm just going to, the reason I'm showing this to you is the surprise that we had here. This is the mutational landscape. It's a complicated slide. It shows 150 patients. Each of these patients over here, each of these represent a different patient, 150 in total. And this is the mutational landscape. The darker boxes here, without going into too much detail, is where there's more mutations happening. And as predicted in the case of prostate cancer, you see a lot of mutations of the testosterone receptor. You see a lot of P53 mutations. You see mutations in the P10 gene. But the big surprise to us was a high frequency of DNA repair abnormalities. And we knew about this in ovarian cancer. We knew about this in breast cancer. We did not anticipate this in prostate cancer. About 25 to 30% of advanced prostate cancers have abnormalities in DNA repair genes. So this really led to a new therapy in prostate cancer. So we, in the oncology world, take advantage of weaknesses that cells have. So we say there's a weakness by the cancer cell's inability to repair DNA. Let's take advantage of that. So this is the concept of synthetic lethality. We take advantage of the mutations in the DNA repair genes that permit and do not repair single-strand breaks and add drugs that facilitate the breakage of the second strand. Remember, if you break both strands, that leads to the death of the cell. So PARP inhibitors are a group of drugs that do this. And they are now approved for the treatment of BRCA-related cancers, particularly ovarian cancer. PARP inhibitors are approved for the treatment of BRCA-related ovarian cancer. So it's now apparent that these DNA repair genes are common in other cancers, and PARP inhibitors will likely be useful. And to make a long story short, a very elegant experiment was done by one of our colleagues in that group of investigators, where he took a group of patients with these DNA repair abnormalities who had prostate cancer and gave them a PARP inhibitor. And lo and behold, with 94% accuracy, patients responded if they had one of those mutations. So it is likely that in the next year we'll have another therapy available for the treatment of prostate cancer. So shifting gears, that was elephants. This is now immunotherapy. I'm going to very briefly go over this. So the first immunotherapy that was approved for the treatment of cancer in general that showed a survival advantage was a very simplistic vaccine. I call it a vaccine, but it's really a cell-based immunotherapy called Cipaluzil-T. And the concept here is to take a prostate protein, in this case it's called prostatic acid phosphatase, and link it to a immunostimulatory molecule, GM-CSF, and administer it to these cells called antigen-presenting cells, which take up the antigen and process the antigen and present the antigen on the surface of the antigen-presenting cell, as you would guess. And it's this presentation that's important in stimulating T cells. And in stimulating T cells are the active part of the immune system, and it's the T cells that presumably have the anti-tumor effect. And this was the benefits of this vaccine, first in class, were demonstrated in the context of a randomized prospective study in men with advanced prostate cancer, where there was an overall improvement in survival in these patients with very far advanced cancer. So this was the first proof of principle that immunotherapy can prolong survival. And what's happened since then has been really staggering in the past 5 years. And first is the development of checkpoint inhibitors. This is a complicated slide, but I'll just sort of give you the general concept in saying that cancer cells are very clever in fending off our immune systems. Our immune systems should be able to kill off foreign cells, but cancer cells find a way to disguise themselves so they can't be recognized as foreign, and there are molecules that they produce that facilitate this this disguise. And a couple of them are CTLA-4. You don't need to know what that is yet. PD-1 and PD-L1. So these are proteins that are involved in protecting the cancer cell from being recognized by the immune system. And antibodies have been developed against these checkpoint inhibitors that have had fantastic results in people. The first that was developed here a number of years ago, a drug called ipilimumab, and it was approved for melanomas, and it's also being studied in other cancers. There's an anti-PD-1 antibody called Pembro, which is approved for melanoma and lung cancer, and it's being studied in a number of other cancers, and an anti-PD-L1 drug that's also being studied in a number of cancers. What I find extremely impressive about this class of agents are that they are very well tolerated, particularly the PD-1, PD-L1 drugs, and that they, as I mentioned before, generating responses that are durable, that last for a long period of time in a subset of patients, maybe 20% of patients or 30% of patients with advanced cancers. So this is really the tip of the iceberg. At the AACR meetings, which just took place, there are a number of other checkpoint inhibitors or checkpoint molecules and potentially inhibitors that are being studied. So this area is exploding right now, and Memorial Sloan Kettering is at the epicenter of this whole activity. Many people are involved in it. Finally, in the arena of CAR T cells, this is also something that was pioneered at Memorial Sloan Kettering. These are molecularly engineered T cells that recognize specific proteins on cancer cells. And what's happened over the past, I would say, 20 years was the first CAR T cell that was developed. The sophistication that has developed over the past 20 years, particularly over the past 10 years at Memorial Sloan Kettering, has been nothing short of staggering in terms of amplifying the effect that the T cell has on the cancer cell, and also in the diversity of the number of cancers that potentially can be addressed with this approach. The big success so far has been in the arena leukemia, but I anticipate that this the successes will broaden quite a bit to extend to other hematologic malignancies and eventually to solid tumors. So this is an incredible area of growth and potential in the area of immuno-oncology, and this institution is an epicenter for its development. So I mentioned this already, durable responses in leukemias and lymphomas, the hematologic malignancies, the role in other tumors is being explored. Finally, before I introduce our speakers, I want to talk about the idea of the clinician scientist. These are very important people. So for many years in the context of cancer, it was very hard to study humans other than clinical trials. So model systems were developed in bacteria, yeast, fruit flies, mice, which were easier to work with, but they really don't as well approximate human disease as actually studying human cells. Although they remain important, and you'll hear probably a little bit about mouse models today, It's so much easier now to interrogate human disease because the tissue is available, the ability to sequence, the ability to understand all the genetics is advancing very rapidly. The technology are advancing, the ability to dissect what we call large data, tremendous amounts of sequencing data, is becoming much easier to do than it had been in the past. As I said before, non-human models still have a role. So at the center of all this is the clinician scientist, the MD that performs science and studies human disease in the context of a laboratory. And they are at the heart of this revolution. So what we need to do at this institution is to identify the best clinician scientists. You'll hear from two of them tonight. We need to train and mentor them appropriately. And these are very difficult times in the funding world. The government is getting out of the funding business, and where grants maybe are funded at the 10% level. So we need to invest in these young investigators in their careers, particularly between their early training and the time that they become independent, and provide them with enough money to be able to become independent. So I would propose to you the creation of a clinician scientist fund to propel young investigators during this early part of their career before they become fully independent.